And welcome back to the Sewing Garage here in County Down, Northern Ireland. Today is very wet and grey today, but it's lovely and cosy here. So let's have some fun and find out more about free motion embroidery. Today I want to talk about what sort of threads to use, because there's lots and lots of different types. I want to talk to you about which needle to use, because it's really important. It'll stop your thread breaking, and sometimes if you know, you just need to use a different needle for whatever fabric you're using. And I also want to show you how to put your fabric in your hoop ready to embroider. And I also want to show you how to choose the image that you're going to use to free motion embroider, and tips on doing that, because that's really, really important. But before we get started with all the technical stuff, I just want to talk a little bit about being creative. If you mention the word creative or paint or draw or sew, 95% of the population will throw their hands up in horror and they'll say, oh, I can't paint, I can't draw, I can't sew. But do you know what? I think everybody has creativity in them. There's loads of people who can make fantastic cakes, like my friend Janice Hunter, who runs Holly's Coffee here in Northern Ireland, in Ballinahinch. If you're ever in Ballinahinch, call into Holly's Coffee. She makes the most creative, unique and delicious cakes and tray bakes. Now that's creativity that's not my talent. I can't bake to save my life. But also, I'm not very good at being very fashion or styled very well. But there's a local girl called Avril Keys, who's a blogger. She runs a blog called A Life to Style. So, and she talks about, she goes to shops and shows you the latest styles. She advises people on best skincare prices, lots and lots of different things. Check her out, she's great. Avril Keys, A Life to Style. But someone once said, being creative is not the finished article. Being creative is enjoying the process of being creative. So if you're making something and you make a mistake, learn from it, enjoy it. Don't beat yourself up. Colour outside the lines. It's only a piece of fabric, it's only a piece of paper. Just have fun. And that's what creativity is all about. It's enjoying the process of being creative. And that's ultimately more important than what you end up with at the end. So let's talk about threads, needles, fabric, and images now. Okay, let's talk about thread. Thread comes in a myriad of colours and also a myriad of textile types. The most common, well, not the most common one, this is one I use, it's cotton. It's called moon thread. Now, I've tons of colours of this, because when I'm painting with my thread, I need different tones of colour. These are great. These run through my machine really easily, and they're £1 each, so they're really economical. The next sort of thread that I use is a polyester thread. Now, this is the more expensive one. This is a Gutermann thread. Now, this would cost about £2 for this little small. It's a little bit more expensive. It's slightly better quality, but I'm going to show you a magic trick. The Gutermann threads are very, very clever, because did you know at the bottom of the Gutermann thread, if you pull the bottom off, there's a needle holder. So you can put your needles inside, safely inside your thread. I didn't know that until recently, but it's a really, really good idea. So instead of tucking your needle into the thread and pricking yourself with a needle, you just pull out the bottom of the Gutermann reels, you put your wee needles in there and store them nice and safely. So isn't that clever? Thank you, Gutermann, you're so clever. But so there's the cotton moon threads, which are £1 each. The Gutermann ones, which are for this size, are about £2 each. But they're speciality threads. This is another type of Gutermann. Now, this is not polyester. This is a viscose thread. And I hope you can see there's a lovely sheen on it. This runs through the machine really nicely. And also here's another viscose one, but it's got a lovely red for doing, I use this for doing robin redbreast tummies. You can get silk thread. This is absolutely gorgeous silk thread that my mama gave me. And I've used this for doing the fringe on the Highland cow. Now this silk thread will not go through my sewing machine. It just will not. It's too thick. Although you can get the silk threads in a thinner form. These will go through slightly better, but I use this just hand embellish at the end of when I finished my work. This thread here, I do not like. It's a Gutermann thread, it's a multicoloured thread, and I thought, oh, that'll be great, I can just sew away and I won't have to change the colour of my thread. But it is unpredictable in the laying down of your colours, and I don't really like it, and I wish I'd never bought it. So, but that's just me, it might be different for you. Other sorts of thread that I don't like, I bought this and I thought, oh, wouldn't that be lovely, it's a metallic thread. And I tried it in my sewing machine and it was breaking every 10 seconds, which is really, really annoying. And changed the tension on the top thread, changed the tension on the bottom thread. It wasn't until I was watching Debbie Shore, who's a girl on Facebook and YouTube, and she's sometimes on TV. She's a very, very good sewing teacher. She was talking about metallic threads, and she said that, well, if you're using a metallic thread, you need to use a metallic needle, which is what I'm going to talk about after this. Using the right needle is important. If you're using metallic thread, it's a funny sort of thread. It's sort of rough, and that's because it's supposed to've got wee bits of metal in it. But you need to use a metallic needle, and a metallic needle has a slightly bigger eye. And the eye of the needle, metallic needle, is coated in, must be silicone or something that makes the metallic threads go through the slippy, makes it go through easier. But I do not like using that, and I wish I'd never bought that one. And this is another one which I don't really use. It's linen thread. I don't know why I bought it, but it might be good for fixing your sails if you're a sailor or something like that, or you needed a very, very strong thread. But I wouldn't use that in my machine. Basically, these are all sorts of different threads you could use, but sewing machines have their own wee personalities, and you can use any thread that your sewing machine likes. If it'll go through your sewing machine, use it. Don't go out specially and buy Gutermann thread or the thread that I use. If it likes it and it goes through, happy days. If it doesn't like it, you're in for a heartbreak. What you need to do is, if your thread starts breaking, you need to check the tension of your top thread, check the tension of your bottom thread, change your needle, make sure, re-thread your whole machine, make sure you've got it through all the right wee grippers, and if that doesn't work, change the thread and throw that thread in the basket for using for hand sewing. So that's all about thread. The next thing, I've mentioned it already, is needles. Using the right needle is incredibly important. I've got some examples of the needles I use. This is a wee packet of universal needles. And sewing machine needles I've got wee numbers. So, and it's a bit like the bathroom scales. The bigger the number, the sturdier or the heavier the needle. So 70 is the sort of neat number that you would use if you were doing dressmaking or using quilting cotton to make quilts. So that would be a 70. The ones I use for doing my free moon potion embroidery are embroidery ones, and they're 75, slightly bigger. I think the thing about this one is the eye of the needle is slightly larger than the universal ones. If you're using not many people sew leather, but if you're making handbags or sewing on, you might want to use a leather needle. They're labelled at 90 or 100. Also, if I was sewing oil cloth, do you know that waterproof fabric, I would use a leather needle. It seems to slip through the fabric more easily. And if you're sewing jeans, there's a special one for jeans. So using the right needle is incredibly important, but also another thing to remember about needles is change your needle often. Some people will sew with the same needle in their sewing machine for years and years and years and never ever think about changing it. And then when they have problems, they'll send their machine off to get serviced and pay 60, 70, 80 pounds. When really what the problem is they need a new needle. Now this is my needle graveyard. Whenever I finished with the needle, I put it in here so it's not going to, so I know that it's it's defunct, it's used. And what I'll do is, these are sharps, so I can take them to the chemist and I'll dispose of them as the wood sharps for maybe an EpiPen or something like that. Or you could take them to your local recycling centre and ask them where you could recycle them. So changing your needle, very, very important. Right, now we're going to talk about the fabric and how to put your fabric in your hoop. This is embroidery hoop type that I use for my work. This is a 10 inch hoop. It measures 10 inches across the middle. And the type of fabric that I use is, you can use calico, which is this sort of cotton, it's quite light. And sometimes I just use it like that on its own. And sometimes I use this stuff here, which is called interfacing. It's got sort of glue on the back and you iron it onto your piece of calico with, and it gives it a wee bit more stiffness. I'm still experimenting with different things because I'm finding that my wee pictures are, because of the density of the free motion embroidery, it's pulling a wee bit. So I'm still experimenting with different interfacings and different fabrics. A fabric that I also use is this stuff here. Now this is curtain lining, and it's quite sturdy curtain lining. And if you go upstairs in Wardens, which is a lovely family run shop in Newton Hards in Northern Ireland, they have a fabric department where they make curtains and lots of different things. But they also have a fabric bargain bin, and everything in it is a pound. So if you're ever in Wardens, go upstairs and rummage around in their fabric bargain bin, because I think I got bits of this about maybe 1.5-2 meters for a pound. And it's nice to embroider on. It's got a lovely finish and it's a wee bit more sturdier than the calico, but as I say, I'm still experimenting to find the one I like the best. But the Wardens fabric bargain bin has some beautiful pieces of velour fabric, of voyage fabric. You just have to go in if you're passing, and sometimes you're lucky and sometimes you're not, but it's a great bargain if you're there. So what I think I'll do today is I will just show you how to use the plain fabric. But if you'll notice on this wee hoop is made of wood. You can get plastic ones, but I like the wooden ones. You'll notice it has a little screw at the top, and it has a little, oh, this one doesn't, but some but the other ones do. What you have to do is you tighten it slightly, not very tightly, so that you can move the inner hoop in and out of the outer hoop. There's two hoops, one sits inside the other. But whenever we were in doing home economics, girls, the boys went off to woodwork or metalwork classes, and they told us, the boys, a secret they didn't tell us girls. So I'm going to tell you a secret about using screwdrivers and screws. Whenever you want to, and it has a wee saying that helps you remember, righty tidy, lefty loosey. So if you want to tighten a screw, you turn it right, righty tidy. If you want to loosen it, lefty loosey. Now this has helped me numerous times whenever I'm doing other things, screwdrivers or putting batteries in, but especially with the embroidery hoops, they have like a wee, so if you want to tighten it, it's righty tidy. You want to loosen it, lefty loosey. So that's one of the secrets that the boys found out that we didn't, but we know it now, so all's well. So what I do when I'm putting my bit of fabric into my hoop is this. Right, this is how I put fabric in the frame. So here's our calico. It's been ironed, and you'll see that there's still a few little wrinkles. When you get your calico home, and sometimes it's been folded on the bolt of fabric in the shop, and there's very, very deep creases, avoid those. You can iron them out, but the last thing you want is your work with a big crease down the middle of it that you can't get out. So there's superficial creases on this, but I don't mind. It's as flat as I like it. So here's my 10 inch embroidery hoop. Now, as I said in the first program, give yourself plenty of space. Don't use the embroidery hoop that's too small, because you'll find, because of the embroidery foot on the sewing machine, there'll be an inch around the perimeter of your embroidery hoop that you can't get to because of the shape of the foot. So bigger rather than smaller, but I think 10 inches is about just about right. Don't go too big, otherwise it'll be hitting against the free arm of your sewing machine, the body of your sewing machine. So here's your embroidery hoop, and what I'm going to do is I'll ease out the inner circle and set it to one side. And what I like to do, I always like to make sure that the wee screw thing is at the top, but that's just me, a wee bit of OCD. And I lay my outer hoop and I put the calico on top of it like that. And then what I do is I push the inner hoop down inside, so it's like that. But what I'll do now is I'll tighten it lefty loosey, righty tighty. So we're turning it right, just turn, just to tighten it slightly. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull the fabric while holding down the hoops. And what this doing, this is tightening the fabric inside. So all the way around, hold the hoop and pull. Don't pull too hard, just moderately. Just pull it like that. All the way around. You can feel it give a little bit, you know that you're pulling it right. So we're nearly back up to the top again. Going round, pulling and holding, pulling and holding. And once I get up to the top, I will tighten it a little bit again, another little tighten and another little pull. And you can see my fabric's still moving a little bit, so there's still a little bit of give there. It's important to do this because if you're going to be sewing on a piece of fabric that's all flappy and moving about, it just makes it more difficult for you and more frustrating. So take the time to do this. It's not wasted time. It makes all the difference. So that's two times round the circle and a last little tighten. And what you should end up with is a piece of fabric that is as tight as a drum. You can hear it, as tight as a drum. So you'd also notice if someone's doing hand embroidery, they will usually be doing it like this with the fabric facing them like that. But whenever you're doing free motion embroidery with a hoop, it's the fabric is flat against the metal plate of the sewing machine, because if you were doing it like that, the needle would be bouncing and it would be too difficult. So we're going to put it under the machine like that. But the next stage is choosing your images and transferring your images onto your fabric. The next thing we're going to talk about is your images. I copy from things and I trace things. And it's not, people have said to me, well, that's cheating. It's not cheating. You can do whatever you like. It's your piece of work, your piece of art. There's no rules. Do what you like, it's yours. But whenever you're choosing your image that you're going to do, make sure you choose something that you like. Don't be choosing something that, you know, you're going to get tired of or you don't like looking at. But it's really important to choose your image carefully. I really like this image. It's of a beautiful, stunning barn owl. I've taken a photocopy from a wildlife book, and as you can see, it's mostly white, which is going to be difficult to translate into thread. But look at the pattern on the wings, absolutely stunning. But there are so many little dots and such detail that would be really difficult to make a nice piece. So you want to make things easy for yourself. You want to do something that's pleasing to your eye. Although I might do this someday if I'm brave enough, but that's going in the back of the cupboard to wait for another day. But here's a subject that a lot of people absolutely adore, a little robin. Now this is a Christmas card, and if you look at the way the wee robin is sitting, he's sitting in a pleasing way. He's got, you can see his round tummy, and this photograph shows he's got the red bit and the white bit, and you can notice, you can see the colours. There's actually a little bit of grey up around here and then across the top of his head. So it's a lovely image. And if you look at the way his wee feet are sitting, they're not sitting at a strange angle, because sometimes images of birds can have their feet sitting all out sideways, and whenever you go to make your image, it looks funny, and somebody will look at it and go, that's funny looking, those feet are not right. So make sure it's a satisfying image to start off with. Now, a word about this. This is quite a big image of a robin. If I was starting off, I would start with a smaller area to free motion embroidery, because it's going to take a lot of thread and a lot of time to do that. But if you're working on a smaller image, it's going to be easier for you to get a result quicker, and it'll be more rewarding for you. I'm not saying don't try that, go ahead and do whatever you want, but I'm just saying if it's your first time doing it, choose an image that is going to be easily finished. But also, if you look at these little birds, I don't know, you can see in this one maybe, they have very, very sharp little feet, and they're quite ugly. The little, I know they need them for clinging onto things, but I use a little bit of artistic license when I'm doing my wee birds, and I don't put in the big claws. For example, in this, the owl one, if you look at his claws, they're absolutely menacing. If I was going to do a picture of that, I think I would either try and do the picture without the feet in it, but the claws look quite scary. So pick and choose what you find pleasing to your eye, and that's what I do sometimes, a little bit of artistic license. But the image that I've chosen that I'm going to show you how to transfer onto fabric is this lovely wee donkey, because I love wee donkeys and a lot of people do too. Now this is again is a birthday card, I think, and he's not too big, and he's got a nice, he's looking at his face on, so we can see both of his eyes. Sometimes with pictures of cows and donkeys and horses, it's a nice photograph. They've turned their head to one side, and one of their eyes you can see, and the other one is just a wee slit of an eye, and it's difficult to get that just right. So this is a good image. It's not too big. There's a nice variation of colour, you know, the white nose, the white eyes, and the white in the ears here. He's quite scruffy as well, which means if you make a mistake, who's going to know? Nobody. That's just the way his hair was. He didn't brush his hair that day. So this is the wee image I'm going to show you next. Okay, so let's get ready to put our image into the frame. Right, what I forgot to do the last time was, once you get your fabric in, you can leave it like that, but it's all floppy. I find it really, really annoying. And what I like to do is I like to cut it off. But a word of warning about scissors, first of all, never, ever, ever cut paper with your fabric scissors. It will blunt them and it will make you cry, because you just won't cut very well. So it's a bit like taking the crust extra pastry off the edge of an apple pie. I just like to cut round. You don't have to do it. This is the way I do it, because I just like it like this. It just annoys me whenever I'm sewing, it gets in my way. So that's what I'm doing. I'm just gently cutting round the edge. So you don't need that. So we've got our hoop, our fabric scissors, and these are my paper scissors, which it has paper written on them. And I will go so far as, some people actually get padlocks and put them on their fabric scissors so nobody can actually use them for paper, because paper will ruin your scissors and you'll just have to buy new ones. So a pair for paper and a pair for fabric. So the next thing we're going to do is we'll put our wee hoop aside for a wee second and we'll get our image. Now here's our wee donkey image, and I've sellotaped a little bit of tracing paper to it just at the top, and the reason why I've just put it at the top is so that I can, if sometimes when you're looking through the tracing paper you can see it but you can't see fine detail, so you can lift your image up just to check where the fine detail is. I'm going to draw him with a 2B pencil. 2B is quite soft, but I've got it really sharpened so that it gives a nice line. The reason why you want a soft pencil is you're going to flip it over and rub on the back side of it to transfer it on. So if it's an HB pencil or if it's too hard, it makes that more difficult. So make life easy for yourself and do it with a softer sort of pencil. So What we're going to do here is we're just getting a suggestion of the shape so that the eyes are in the right place, the nose is in the right place, and the ears and the furry bits are in the right place, because the human eye is a very complex thing, and when you look at a picture that someone's painted, you know immediately if it's not right. You know, without even having to go to a class, you go, oh no, that's looking a bit funny. So tracing an image means you're placing the eyes at the correct level from the nose. Just, it's making it easier. It's not cheating. You know, just, you're making yourself, your life easier. You're having fun. There's no rules. Just go for it. So what I'm going to do is, I know his hair is a wee bit sort of raggedy at the top. I'm just putting in the inside of his ear, and there's lots of bits of fluffy bits there on the outside of his ear. And we're coming down, and now there's a little dark line, so we'll just do a line coming down onto his shoulder, onto his back, and then this wee bit here is his mane, and the mane of a donkey sticks straight up, so I'm keeping my wee sort of strokes straight. So onto the other ear, he's got little shaggy ears on the other side, doing the outline of the inside of his ear and doing all the wee shaggy bits there coming down. Now the eyes are quite important. What I can see through the tracing paper is sort of like an almond shaped black eye, but I know part of that blackness is his fur, it's not all his eye, so I'm going to lift up just so I can remember his eye is round, it's not almond shaped the way I can see it through. So I'm just going to put the eye in first and keep it nice and round, and put the wee highlight in so that you remember where it is. And also on the other side now, it's round and the wee highlight is there. So I'm going to put in the rest of the black. I'm not going to colour it in black. I'm just going to put a wee outline so that I know that it's there, because whenever I'm doing on the machine, I can look at the picture and see that's black. Now, this little bit here is white, so we'll just put a little circle round to show that that's a different colour. And we'll come down the side of his nose. And his nostrils are sort of like a crescent moon shape, so we'll just draw in that. And down the side of his wee muzzle. I'm not putting in fine detail because I'll be doing that. It's just a suggestion of the correct shape of him. So there we go. Well, and there's the wee bit that of his muzzle, his eyes, his ears, his muzzle. And so that's our image ready to go on to the hoop. So we'll bring our hoop in. Make sure the wee screw is at the top, just keeps it all nice. And I will take off the image of my donkey. And what I'll do is I will turn him over the other way round and place him in the middle of my hoop. And I get a little bit of tape and I will tape him at the top. And I will smooth him out and tape him at the bottom so that he doesn't move, because if your image moves, you'll get a double image and you don't want that. So, and I think I'll put a wee bit of tape on this side just to, because it's holding up. There we go. So now we've got an outline of our donkey on our fabric. And in school, whenever you were tracing something, you always traced it with pencil and then you turned it over and you went over it again with another pencil. But I find for what I'm doing is I use the rounded end of this wee marker pen. And what I do is I go over the lines and I'm just rubbing it quite hard, any old way, making sure your image stays put so it doesn't move around. Just going over all the lines so you're transferring a suggestion of the image onto your fabric. Make sure the eyes, you do those really well. It may seem very crude, but it's just a suggestion of the shape. You're going to be putting in depth and texture later on. So before you lift it off, make sure you just go over it, just to make sure. And we take it off. You'll see we have a lovely wee donkey face on our fabric. And now what I'll do is I'll switch to an HB pencil, a very sharp one, to make sure the lines, and I'll just go over the lines that haven't come out as well. Although the image of this is quite good. And as I say, he's a donkey, so he's quite sort of untidy hair, so just make his wee shaggy hair. Just go around the outline of his eyes. The image may look a bit funny now, but once we start colouring in and putting paint on, then that's going to be the next step. You don't have to put paint on, but I do it because it makes it easier, and I'm all for things that make life easier. So there we go. There's our little doggy on our inner hoop, ready to be painted. Okay, the next stage with our image is putting a little bit of colour in, and the reason why I do this is because whenever I'm sewing on the machine, it's such a fast process that I do look at the image to look at the colours, but if I've got the colours straight in front of me on the fabric, it just makes it easier for me. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to start off with a wee bit of dark brown. I'm not going to paint the whole thing. I'm just putting in a suggestion of colour just as a guide for me. So I can see around the top of his wee ears is sort of dark. So I'm just going to put in a little bit of dark there. And some of his little fringe is coming down. Now, you'll have to remember that the image that you're using is back to front. So his hair is going off to the right in the photograph, so when the image is going to be going off to the left, so I'm putting a little bit off to the left. As you can see, it's not terribly accurate, but it just gives me a suggestion of colour that I, and also it gives me a little bit of I'm doing the direction of the hair growth. See, down his nose it sort of parts like a parting. I'm using acrylic paints because acrylic paints are strange paints. You can water them down watercolours, but you can also use them thickly like oil paints. But the good thing about acrylic paints is they dry really quickly, and once they dry they're waterproof, so they won't smudge or anything. But the disadvantage to the acrylic paints is once they're on your plate, you know, you can't, if you've put out a big amount, it'll dry as hard as a rock and that'll be it. You have to throw it out. So I use them sparingly. I'm just putting it in his wee muzzle there. I'll do a tiny little bit of light grey around his eye, just around the Now, you don't have to do this. This is just the way I do it. You do it any which way you want. With black, on the sewing machine and with the paint, I never use black straight out of the tube because it's so inky dark. It's almost not, it's unnatural nearly. So I'm just going to paint in his eyes, and I'm painting around the wee highlight because, oh, well, it's filled it in itself, so we'll just have to forget about the highlight in that one. We'll try this one. I'll try not to paint the highlight. I think the paint was too watery there. So we've got his eyes in. The Let's see where else. There's a bit of grey. There's a tiny bit of grey inside his ear. Sometimes whenever I'm sewing, especially if it's little birds and things, I won't actually sew over the paint because I just like to leave it the way it is. But that's all up to you. I'm just filling in little bits of white here. And again, I've squeezed the white paint out of the tube, but I've sort of toned it a little bit with the tiniest bit of brown so that it's not bright white. And even whenever you paint it on, you can hardly see it, but it's just a suggestion. It's just a guideline of colour. And I'm going to do his wee muzzle, but it's going to be a tiny little bit grey. So there we go. It's very rough and ready, but that's enough of a suggestion to help me get sewing. Come back next time and we will get onto the sewing machine. Well, that's us all ready to go to the sewing machine, and that's what we'll be doing in the next episode, and I hope you can join me. I hope you've learnt something today and haven't minded me babbling on, but it's all very necessary because failing to prepare is preparing to fail. Whatever you do creatively, I hope you enjoy doing it. Have a go, and you will enjoy yourself, I promise you. Kirsty Alsop, who's one of my craft heroines, said that free motion embroidery is like the crack cocaine of craft. Now, I'm not sure whether that's true or not, but why don't you have a go and find out for yourself. See you next time. Bye.